Why can't Darwin's origin of species account for the origin of phyla?
The origin of phyla present a particular problem because they all appear in the geological record during a very narrow window of geological time. All of them that are well skeletonized so that we have a chance of actually finding them in the fossil record appear in a very narrow window of time. Naturally, some of the little minute ones that are soft-bodied, we either never see at all or we just see once in a while when we get lucky. So you really can't tell when they've begun from the fossil record itself. But for the ones that have good skeletons and a pretty good chance of being preserved, they just come in lickety-split in this big explosive appearance. So,
how long did it take the major body plans to appear?
A good guess would be about 30 million years, but each phylum did not necessarily take 30 million years to originate. On the contrary, it may have been just a few million years or even less to generate the body plans that we call phyla from their ancestral body plans. But the window stayed open for maybe 30 million years, during which successive waves of phyla appeared.
How many phyla have arisen since the Cambrian?
None. They all came in then, as far as we can tell. Let's say the fossil record is consistent with the model that they all originated within that 30 million year frame.
What has prevented the evolution of new phyla since the Cambrian explosion?
Well, one would guess the presence of the phyla that the world sort of filled up. That is, there are no vast areas of environmental space that are open, so there are no adaptive opportunities for novelties to occur. There have been a few really big extinctions during geological time, of course. The biggest of all was in the Permo-Triassic, when perhaps over 90% of the world's species disappeared. But we didn't get any new phyla in afterwards, even though there were a lot of adaptive space open, so a lot of opportunities, probably because we already had all the phyla, and a few species made it through, or numbers of species made it through from each phyla, so there they are. They fill up adaptive space a lot quicker than if evolution, so to speak, started all over and had to invent a whole new phylum. So what you get is simply branches off the major trunks of the phyla you've already got.
Are you saying that Darwinian competition prevented major new body plans from arising after the Cambrian?
Preclusion is almost a better word. If you're actually in control of an adaptive space, let's say, it's impossible for somebody who isn't in control, who is outside of it, to actually evolve into it if you're there. What has to happen if something new is to occur is to remove you and then open up that adaptive space, and then there's a chance for somebody else to move in. But your being there indicates that your fitness in that adaptive space is greater than the taxa or the lineages that are around it.
Why can't microevolution be extrapolated to account for major evolutionary change?
Of course, there is a population genetics of all changes, of all changes, evolutionary changes. So in a sense, all the changes are microevolutionary in that they have to pass through a populational process. But the kinds of changes that are usually visualized as microevolutionary are changes to structural genes, which change eye color or growth rates or something like that. And it can't be simple single changes like that added up that produce the new phyla, because they come in much too fast. The rate of change in species lineages through time is well known. We've got 500 million years of looking at it. And the rate at which new morphology originated near the base of the Cambrian is 540 million year time intervals. Just much too fast.
Can paleontologists trace the animal phyla back to a common ancestor?
No, there's no fossil evidence for the very first animal. But if you go back beyond the base of the Cambrian, we do have a fairly rich fossil record, perhaps 40 or 50 million years before this explosion occurred. And the body plans of the organisms there don't really help us in understanding what went on during the transition. The ancestors of most of the phyla that we see from the Cambrian up are not represented by soft-bodied fossils, though we have trails and tracks that had to be left by organisms of a certain grade, because in order to furrow the sediment, you need, for example, body wall muscles and some kind of hydrostatic skeleton that permits you to antagonize them in order to make furrows of the kind we see. And some of these furrows have fecal pellets in them, so we know these bugs had guts that ran right through. They weren't like flatworms or something. And to do that requires a certain complexity. And we can trace the change in complexity of animals. Maybe the best single index of complexity is the number of cell types you have. Of course, protozoa have just one cell type, right? And we have 210. You look at a jellyfish, it's got maybe 10 or 12. Look at a mollusk, it's got maybe in the low 40s, and so on. So that as time went on, the number of cell types and therefore the complexity of the body plans or organisms increased. And it's pretty linear if you plot it against geological time. The reason it would be linear is just that the variance in any random walk is going to increase linearly through time. There's not necessarily anything magic about a gradual steady increase in complexity, but it would just naturally follow from a random process in which you could either get more or fewer cell types at a given step. And as time goes on, you're not counting the moves to fewer cell types, but only those to more cell types, so the complexity of the more complex organisms would increase linearly through time. That way, I'm trying to respond to your answer about when animals started, actually. That way, if you trace the complexity of organisms back from today to, the Cambrian, when they had maybe 40 cell types, 45, back to when we first see the trace fossils that indicate an organism that might have had 30 cell types or something like that, and just keep the line going down to when it hits one, that turns out to be about 680 million years ago. And although we don't have animal fossils from that time, after all, they were only little blobs of a few cells and a couple of cell types, maybe. And wouldn't be expected to fossilize unless we get incredibly lucky. Why, from theoretical considerations like that, you can sort of narrow down the time when they probably started.
Does the Cambrian explosion represent a sudden and dramatic increase in both disparity and complexity?
I don't think the Cambrian explosion of phyla indicates a great jump in complexity. What seems to have happened was that we have this increasing number of cell types among the more complex organisms in a number of lineages. And they began to reach a level, which is 40 to 50 cell types, at which a rather complex body plan of the sort we now think of as being higher invertebrate, annelids, arthropods, and stuff like that, was possible. At lower cell type numbers, you just don't have the building blocks, because, of course, each tissue involves a number of cell types. Each organ involves a number of tissues, and each organ system a number of organs, and each organism a number of organ systems. So you get a complex organism, need more cell types to support this construct right up this hierarchy. And the number of cell types then is very sensitive to the complexity of the organism as a whole. And you can't go from 1 to 55 cell types overnight. You've got to go from 54 to 55. So the organisms just before the Cambrian boundary probably had like 40 cell types, and just after 42 or so. I'm kidding, you know, it's not that close. But what we probably saw was the arrival during this 30 million year window of a number of lineages at a level of complexity that permitted them to form the kind of body plans that were often co-adapted with skeletons, for example. When that happened, we begin to see them because the skeletons leave a fossil record suddenly. Or they begin to burrow, which takes a certain level of complexity of form. So when they hit this level of structural complexity that they can make burrows, we begin to see the burrows happened about the same time within this same window. So the Cambrian explosion is probably a radiation at about the same level of complexity. And there must have been earlier radiations as well. But they weren't radiations of forms that could leave a mark in the fossil record that would impress us very much. But when this radiation happened, this level of complexity, we began to get skeletons, and bang, suddenly we've got a fossil record.
How is the number of cell types in organisms relevant to the Cambrian explosion?
The cell types themselves are most important because they indicate that the genome, the genetic system that underlies the ground plan of the body, is getting more complicated. Because all the cells in our body, of course, have the same genotype, the same genes in them, except for sex cells, and which have half the dose. But on the other hand, we have 210 cell types, you and I. We're fairly high tech. And each cell has a different phenotype. Nerve cells look very different from muscle cells and function very differently. If they're built from exactly the same, they have exactly the same genes in them. What this means is that different bunches of genes are turned on in different cells. So there is some system which specifies which cells are going to be expressed, and which genes are going to be expressed in which cells, and how many cells of that type you get, and where they go, and all this stuff. So there's this genetic regulatory apparatus, which we're beginning to understand. And there are certain genes, homeobox genes are one example, which are transcriptional regulators and which regulate which genes are expressed in which cells. So what we're seeing when we see a multiplication of cell types, we're seeing a complexity of gene regulation increasing. And one reason, perhaps, that the Cambrian explosion could be so rapid was because we built up this level of complexity, as I'm saying, as measured by cell type numbers. But what that means is that the genomes at that time were themselves complex enough to code for a certain level of body plan. And then reshuffling the expression of these genes, you've already got them. Reshuffling them to express them in different morphologies as duck soup compared with adding new complexity. So to go from two cell types to 40 was tough and took many millions of years. Once you've got 40, though, there's a lot of stuff you can make with 40 cell types, and that's what we're seeing, so to speak, at the Cambrian-Precambrian boundary. Since then, the number of cell types being added to organisms has tended to continue to increase more or less linear, stochastically linearly. We think, until today, and here we are with 210 cell types. Come back in 100 million years and there'll be something around with 260 cell types or something that will make us look pretty simple.
Is the punctuated equilibrium model of Eldridge and Gould sufficient to account for the origin of the higher taxa?
It isn't. They didn't say that the punctuated equilibrium model accounted for the origin of higher taxa, but other people have suggested that that's one way to speed evolution up, is to have these sudden jumps in speciation events, which is the pattern we see. We see lineages not changing too much, or maybe they're changing a little bit, but then when a new lineage splits off from it, it doesn't necessarily change in any directions that the parent lineage was changing. It's a whole new departure. Presumably this change occurred in a small population that evolved very rapidly and generated a new morphology in such a small length of geological time and in such small populations, probably restricted areas, that we just don't see them in the fossil record. We just don't pick them up, which makes sense with what we know about how well the fossil record resolves events. The trouble with that, with saying that that speeds things up, is that it's almost the opposite. In the punctuated equilibrium model, while you have lineages in stasis that just aren't changing morphologically for long periods of time, and then there's this sudden jump, relatively sudden jump, to a novel morphology, and then you have another lineage appear. And the part that's in stasis then is not changing rather than changing. And if you want to evolve rapid morphological change, stasis is the last thing you want. What you want is change. And you can't get the kind of change you need out of small populations for just keeping them small for millions of years and letting them go on changing and changing and changing. That won't work, because small populations have trouble getting rid of deleterious genes. More mutations are deleterious by far than are useful. So the rate of appearance of deleterious genes is high in all populations, but in large populations, selection gets rid of them. In very small populations, though, selection is powerless to get rid of them. There's so few genes in the population, and just the chances of recombining are in charge of the direction of change in the gene frequency. So whether a gene increases in frequencies or decreases in frequencies has little to do with its contribution to the fitness of the organism, and more to do with just chance in small populations. So if you get a small population and try to keep it small for very long, the drift load, the number of deleterious mutations, is going to increase and increase and increase, and pretty soon the population is going to go extinct. The only way to save it is to let it get large. As soon as you do that, the rate of change slows down, and also it probably is going to appear in the fossil record if it gets really big, so we're going to see it again. So you can't keep these changes hidden for long periods of geological time when you're going from one phylum to another or something like that, from one body plan to another. That won't work.
Do we need theories of stasis in order to fully explain the natural history of life on Earth?
Yeah, certainly we do. Good question. Yeah, when it dawned on everyone that Eldridge and Gould were right and that stasis was a very common pattern, why, everyone rushed back to the drawing boards and began figuring out what the processes were that would prevent change rather than push it along. And I guess there are two chief ideas. One would be ecological, that is, that things are constrained ecologically and there's no particular place for them to go. And the other would be developmental, that there are developmental constraints that tend to prevent change until you break through, punctuate the equilibrium, so to speak, and then you can make a jump to a new morphology. But the developmental processes tend to get canalized to produce a particular small range of phenotypes, and it's hard to break out. And that's why they use the term punctuated equilibrium, I guess.
How long did it take to produce the disparity of the phyla? How much diversity existed within each phylum in the Cambrian?
Well, we can't actually determine from, since we don't have a record of these phyla earlier, we can't actually measure how long it took them to arise. The one way to get at this, the very indirect way, is by the cell type number, which gives us kind of a measure of how fast complexity increases. And we know about how complex a body plan has to be in order to exist at that level, at that grade of complexity. Most of the phyla that appear have very few species at first. And indeed, if you use some sneaky way to estimate how many species there were in the Lower Cambrian, and then count up the numbers of, say, classes or orders there were, why, it turns out that its ballpark analysis would be about every 40th species was at least a new class, something like that. Now, today that isn't true. Today, morphological diversity is not that great. the increase in morphological diversity is not that great, and many genera have 40 species in them, and every 40th species might be a new genus if you're lucky or something like that. In the Cambrian, however, the morphological disparity was increasing very rapidly between lineages. Almost certainly, in my opinion, this is a reflection of the fact that the population genetics of the day was dealing with patterns of gene expression, with these transcriptional regulators within the genome, and not simply with changing genes from one structural gene to another, changing eye color or something simple like that. So the changes then could be greatly speeded up, because one transcriptional regulator can control the expression of literally hundreds of genes. So you just need one mutation to take a whole battery of genes and express them in some other time or place or in some other way in the body. So once you've got them, then it's just, you can reshuffle them in different patterns.
Darwin believed that the increasing diversity of species would gradually lead to the disparity of the higher taxa. The fossil record appears to contradict Darwinian theory. Disparity precedes diversity. Could you comment on this problem?
Well, it's certainly true, as Steve Gould has pointed out a lot, many times, that Darwin first thought of things changing gradually, and that his works are pervaded with that idea. You can find paragraphs in them and sentences in them where he admits of other possibilities, but then he'll go back to using a vocabulary that implies gradual change. So if Darwin were working on the Precambrian-Cambrian boundary, he would suggest that animals started a long, long time ago and then gradually diversified, and we just don't happen to see them until the Cambrian-Precambrian boundary, but that their ancestors are down there and their ancestors are not very different from they are, and that there's this long history of gradual divergence. The fossil record doesn't suggest this is so, because we've got a fossil record before the Cambrian-Precambrian boundary, and the ancestral types that Darwin would have predicted, or that you'd predict from a Darwinian viewpoint, simply aren't there. And they can't have been there. One reason, for example, is that nobody was burrowing back then. You can't get rid of burrows very easily from the sediments. If you make a burrow, that's a structure in the sediment. And even if you cook the sediment up and metamorphose it, it only makes that burrow stand out more, makes it easier to see. It's disrupting the texture of the sediment. And there are no burrows before about this Cambrian explosion, before this window at least. And so nothing was burrowing, which means there were no body plans around that could burrow. And the implications for that are that we only had simpler body plans than those we see at the Cambrian-Precambrian boundary. And there's a lot of lines of logic that lead to this conclusion. Since we do see in the early Cambrian all these new body plans coming in, the story from then on is the gradual winnowing out of them and the creation of kind of novel branches from them as opportunities opened up. But you have to have the body plan before you can modify it into the branches. So, of course, you had to have the phylum before you can get classes of that phylum or orders of those classes. So, in a sense, the top-down system is just inherent in the geometry of a tree.
Do you have some examples of your latest research findings?
Yeah, while we were taping, there was a knock at the door and we had to stop for a second, and one of my graduate students appeared and handed in this chart, which is hot off the press. It's I haven't had a chance to look at it hard, but it's one of a series of computer simulations of a random increase in the number of cell types in lineages under a model of random occurrence of more or fewer cell types within a lineage. And this would be the leading edge of the increase. This particular one has a plateau in it. I have a few of them here. Some of them just go right on up without plateaus. Since there are random elements in the model, there are many possible minor departures from linearity. Here's one that's even better. And, shows a nicer increase. But at any rate, this sort of simulation shows that the principle that cell type number can increase as a result of a random process is valid.
Dr. Valentine, what first interested you in the subject of paleontology?
Well, like most kids, it was dinosaurs when I was young. There was not nearly the amount of dinosaur material that's around today after Jurassic Park, for example, but there was some, and they fascinated me. But then I forgot all about them and didn't pay much attention to them as a teenager, of course. And I was a GI in World War II, and after the war, I got the GI Bill and was able to go to college, which I hadn't really planned on. And when I enrolled, I was handed a long list of possible majors, and I looked down the list and there were horrible things on it like physics and mathematics and so on. And finally I came to geology, where I knew paleontology was taught, and dinosaurs immediately came to mind, and I thought, wonderful, that's just what I want. So although I've never done a dinosaur in my life, why, I did go into paleontology because they existed in my background, my childhood.
Who has had the most significant influence upon your career?
George Gaylord Simpson, without a doubt. He was a vertebrate paleontologist, although I'm an invertebrate guy. And he was a mammal worker. He didn't do dinosaurs either. But he was an evolutionary theoretician. And he wrote a couple of wonderful books in the 40s and 50s, which showed that the fossil record could be used not just as help in dating past events so that the geologists could get things right, but that it could be used as a source of evolutionary information that from which theories could be built, and he did that. And he wrote a wonderful book called Tempo and Mode in Evolution, which explores the rate and sort of evolutionary sequence that you see in the fossil record.
Yeah. What have been the most rewarding aspects of your work?
Well, the most interesting times, at least, have been when I found something out that hasn't been known before. You get a high, like controlled substances or something, and you really, at least I have not been able to sleep sometimes after tumbling onto something that I thought was good. Sometimes it turns out it's not good and it's wrong, but nevertheless, the enjoyment of those moments is irreplaceable. And it's also fun just to sit around and hypothesize about things, working up to looking for real evidence to see what's going on.
The focus of your research has been the origins of animals and of the major animal groups, the phyla. What are some of the major problems?
One of the troubles with working on the origins of animals is that the fossil record isn't great. It's not too bad, but it's certainly incomplete. And especially when you get back to the earliest parts of the fossil record, why, it's a little difficult to know how much you're seeing and how much you're seeing as just an artifact of preservation and not really representative of what was going on at the time. Darwin didn't know about the earliest fossil record that we have now. The earliest rocks he knew about that had fossils in them, we now know are about 525 million years old, something like that, just a little over half a billion. And we now have fossils from about 45 million years earlier than that, which might not sound like much when you're kicking half a billion around, but it's a very critical time, and it's shown us the nature of the earlier fauna, and we understand why Darwin didn't know about it. And although we're not absolutely sure how complete the record is then, why, we have a pretty good idea that we can trace the evolution of the general grades of animal organization.
What are the earliest animals like?
The earliest fossils that we do find during this interval where new things have come to light are not exactly what we expected, and certainly not what Darwin would have expected. They're not the obvious ancestors of the forms we see today. There are two types of fossils found. One, body fossils, the actual impressions and remains of these early organisms. And most of these look like they're sea anemone or jellyfish sorts of organisms, at that sort of grade of organization. And in addition, and very importantly, there are lots of trails left by organisms that were crawling through the sediment. And some of them have little levees on the side. Some of them demonstrate that the animals were scrunching along, sort of like an inchworm or something, inching their way along. And some of them have fecal pellets, or what are interpreted as fecal pellets, laid down in the trail, which is very common today. And a worm that can make a trail like that, an organism that can make a trail like that, is getting pretty far along. It requires body wall muscles and some kind of an internal skeleton, perhaps a fluid skeleton or a tissue skeleton that's capable of antagonizing the muscles. And once you have a body that's encased in muscles, as you must have had, in order to be able to actually displace the sediments like these guys were doing, that means that your interior then is cut off from the outside. So it implies that you require a circulatory system, at least if you're as big as these guys were, which were measured in perhaps centimeters as far as length goes, and so on. So just the presence of these crummy little trails, which are just little squiggles in the ancient sediment, demonstrates that the organisms had progressed to a fairly advanced stage of organization, better than your average flatworm. Flatworms are kind of at the base of the family tree of bilaterian organisms. They can't make trails like that, really. They can glide along on the surface, they glide along on cilia, and sometimes they'll make a little mark on the sediment, but they're not capable of making trails like that. And they don't have circulatory systems, which is one reason they're flat. So if you're round and as big as these guys were, you're smarter than the average flatworm, and probably at an early molluscan sort of grade, like chitons or the aplecophorans, is where the rare class of mollusks that look like little slugs, sort of.
What was life on Earth like in the early Cambrian?
Just about 530 million years ago, there's a sudden change in the nature of the fossil record. And although the traces continue on up until today and become more diverse and more abundant all the time, these trails, and they're joined by very complex trails, lots of burrows, and the animals become sophisticated in their search patterns. We can see them searching very cleverly, not crossing their trails very often to plow through the same old sediment again and so forth. These traces are joined by a whole new array of body plans and represented by skeletal debris in about 530 million years ago. And a lot of the skeletal debris is enigmatic also. We're not sure just what organisms it should be associated with, but we've gotten lucky a few times and been able to piece together we found some body fossils where the skeletal elements were articulated, and from these hints, been able to piece together other disarticulated skeletons into whole animals, or more or less whole animals. So we have some idea of what some of these early forms look like. In addition to these enigmatic groups, there are a few members of living phyla that appear about this time. The brachiopods, the mollusks, and traces that suggest there were arthropods around, although we haven't seen any body fossils of arthropods. Arthropods, of course, have legs, which these other groups don't, and they're able to scratch the sediment and make distinctive marks and we find these traces. So we're pretty sure there were actually arthropods around. And the numbers of higher kinds of animals that appear then, the numbers of differently organized forms, are greater than the numbers of differently organized forms that exist in the world today. Believe it or not, there was an incredible explosion over just a few tens of millions of years, or possibly even less, during which a great number of body plans, very distinctive sorts of organisms, some of them probably don't belong to living phyla, but were phyla of their own. Others belong to extinct major subdivisions of phyla, like classes and orders. There are about 155 orders known from this time period of explosive evolution in the early Cambrian and late Precambrian. And of these, about 90% are extinct. So they're primitive orders, but many of them do belong to groups that are still alive today, and many don't appear to. So there's been some turnover and sorting out of these body plans.
Do these numerous Cambrian groups represent major increases in complexity over the simpler late Precambrian forms?
One might think that since the fossils we see in the late Precambrian look rather simple, the body fossils, cnidarian grade jellyfish looking things, and the fossils that come in the Cambrian look much more complicated and include, not too far above the base, real arthropods do come in the second stage, and echinoderms, and most of the living phyla that have skeletons and are capable of leaving remains of the skeletal remains do so during these few million years. But that's probably not the case. It's probably the case that the organisms in the late Precambrian were also very complex, just a step less complex than the ones in the Cambrian. And things that lead us to believe that, the evidence that leads us to believe that, is based on measures of the complexity of organisms. Maybe the best way to characterize complexity in an animal is by the number of cell types they have. Of course, amoebas and things like that just have one cell type, right? So that's easy to count. And jellyfish have, there's a range. Some are more complicated than the others, but they may have 5 to 10 or 12 cell types, something like that. Sponges about that range, a little less maybe. And then you get into your sort of standard higher invertebrate like arthropods and annelids. And if you look at the more primitive members of these groups, they might have 30, 40 cell types in that range, 45 sometimes. You and I have over 200 different types of cells, so we're really high tech and clear out of the range of these early organisms. The kind of organisms that begin leaving trace fossils in the late Precambrian, when we first see animal traces, just these little squiggles that I said had to be moderately elaborate, those things must have had about 30 cell types, judging by how many organ systems and tissues you need to run an animal like that. So if we put the date of the first appearance of these trails as about roughly the time that 30 cell types evolved, and then we go to the Cambrian, and where we have skeletal fossils of phyla, and we know how complex they are on the basis of their cell types, and we plot those against the date they first appear. We keep doing that through geological time, fish, amphibians, birds, and finally us. We get a nice curve that just goes up very smoothly through geological time. And if we trace it back then, from 210 or so where we are, back through all these different grades of organisms and their origination, and back to the late Precambrian, it's going to intersect zero or one at some time, not too much earlier. And it looks to me as if the earliest metazoans originated about 600 million years ago, not very much earlier than we begin picking them up. Two graduate students of mine, Alan Collins and Chris Meyer, have generated a computer program which mimics the rise in cell type number through geological time, starting with one species and then doubling it, and then, you know, having a speciation rate that goes through time, and also adding the number of cell types in at a rate that is appropriate to the fossil record we see. And when you make models like that, it turns out you get just exactly the same kind of curve out of it that you that we see. That is, you the number of cell types, in fact, rises quite rapidly at first, partly because you can't go lower than one cell type, right? You can't have nothing. So if you have one or two cell types, there's no place to go but up. So there's a floor under these diversifying organisms beneath which they can't fall. However, after they get away from, let's say, after they get to 10 or 20 cell types, they can go to 19 just as easily as they can go to 21, say, if they're at 20. There's no reason, there's no directionality in this model. There's nothing pushing them to higher cell types. It's just that through time, there's just a natural dispersion of cell type number. And it just, the upper bound of complexity, therefore, just increases most rapidly at first, and then a little less rapidly, and a little less rapidly, and so on, up till today. It's still increasing. And you know, give us another 50 million years, and we think we're pretty hot stuff. You know, there'll be something around that's even more complicated if this trend goes on. And because the increase is most rapid at first because of this floor to complexity, why, that means that the time to the earliest animal is even shorter than you'd guess by just running a straight line back to zero, because the earliest time in animal evolution is the time of the most rapid increase in complexity. And that's one reason that the earliest animals may be as early, as late as just 600 million years ago, which is maybe half of what people have been guessing.
What were the ancestors of the early Cambrian forms like?
Well, that's a really good question. Since we don't actually have their bodies, we just have their trails and traces. And oddly enough, molecular biology is coming to our rescue here, because the molecular biologists are able to describe trees of relationship, kind of family trees of all organisms. And if you do this for phyla and do it by using molecular data, you get a pattern that makes sense with the fossil record. How it works is that if you have a population and a given gene in that population, why, it's essentially the same in all the individuals. It might be very slight variations in the, and then you split the population into two different species eventually, or the descendants of the population become two species, and these species eventually turn into different phyla. Trace the phyla back, eventually you come to a common ancestor. So you start with the common ancestor, the genes are similar, and then you let evolution go on for millions of years independently in the two lineages, and the genes gradually become more and more different, maybe not so gradually. And so if you then measure the differences between the genes, you can tell how closely related these two lineages are. And some genes turn over so slowly that they haven't changed too much in half a billion years. Other genes turn over so fast that they change in thousands of years. And they're useless for looking at the origin of phyla, because they turned over so fast that they start repeating themselves and you just can't make any sense out of them. But with the genes, which the code of which evolves relatively slowly, why, you can then tell which lineages are more closely related to what and get a branching order of the origin of new founders of phyla. And when we look at that tree that the molecular biologists have, through much work, carefully worked out, it's still early times. We by no means have it all worked out, and there may be mistakes in it still. But in principle, we'll soon know a lot more about these relationships. When you look at that tree, it makes sense with the fossil record because, for example, take three of the really important phyla today, the mollusks, clams and snails, the arthropods, insects and crayfish and so on, and the annelids, earthworms and marine relatives of the earthworms. And, the classic hypothesis for the evolution of these groups was that the mollusks came off first. They're sort of primitive looking and don't have many features. They don't look very complicated. And then the annelids branched off second, closely related to the mollusks, so that the mollusks and annelids branched off from each other. And then the annelids developed a segmented architecture, and then arthropods branched off from the annelids. And the arthropod architecture is a bit different from the annelid architecture in that the arthropods have an exoskeleton, and their main body cavity, the fluid that antagonizes the muscles and that provides them with trigger and keeps their bodies firm, is blood, essentially. It's a hemocoelic space. Within annelids, that's not true. The main body cavity in annelids is the coelom, a cavity inside the third layer or mesodermal layer. The blood layer is between that layer and other layers. So the arthropods were thought to have branched off from the annelids, and the process by which arthropods were derived has been called arthropodization, which means they gained all the things that arthropods have that annelids don't have, like exoskeletons and expanded hemocoel blood spaces, and they lost the things that the annelids have that they don't have, such as this coelomic cavities, that fluid-filled cavities that annelids use to burrow, to antagonize their body wall muscles so they can scoot along, burrow, and swim or whatever they do, crawl. But if you look at the molecular tree, you see that the pattern is somewhat different. Again, we're not sure this will stand up, but it apparently is going to. The annelids and arthropods branch very early, and on the annelid side of the tree, branching later than this branch between arthropods and annelids, are a number of phyla that include mollusks. So the mollusks are not down here as an ancestor in the branching order, but actually are derived from annelids, which means that in fact, the most likely explanation is that this ancestor that was present when the branching occurred was neither an annelid nor an arthropod, nor probably a mollusk, but something that could be a common ancestor to them all, something even simpler than any of them. Some kind of worm that had a blood vascular system and was kind of round and but was not yet segmented in either the way that the arthropods are segmented or that the annelids are segmented, would make a nice common ancestor for all these groups. And of those groups, it's the mollusks that are least derived or least changed from this ancestor worm. But they didn't branch first. And that means that the branching occurred among this ancestor worm grade, among worms with this body plan I've been describing. And then, independently, the arthropods evolved from one of its branches, the annelids from another, and the mollusks from another. And it happens that the branch that the mollusks evolved from was a later branch than some of the earlier branches. So this branching pattern had nothing to do with how they turned out. They weren't branching because they were going to be annelids or mollusks. They were just branching because they were going to be different species. And then in the course of time, in the sweep of events, these lineages turned into or evolved different body plans. Now, if we go back to this kind of proto-mollusk that was the common ancestor of all these groups, or the most likely one, it's just a perfect bug
to have been crawling around the late Precambrian seafloor and making the squiggles and trace fossils that we see in those sediments. So we do have traces, almost surely, of the common ancestor of all these phyla I've been talking about in the late Precambrian. We just don't have a body fossil of it because they were soft-bodied worms, and they just don't leave body fossils very often.
What happened to all of the 135 to 140 orders that became extinct?
Okay, so then in the lower Cambrian, we have this burst of evolutionary activity, which produces an even wider array of types of organisms than we have with us today. Not very many species. If our best guess at how many species there were back then puts it just in the thousands or low tens of thousands versus millions today. Yet there were more different architectural styles present in this small fauna then than there is today. Very, very different. And the first, I once calculated that about every 40th species during the Cambrian, Precambrian explosion of body types generated at least a class. So today, 40 species won't get you anything, just a group of species. But in those days, evolution was doing things differently from what it's doing now. It was creating novel body plans, not just more species. So it's clear that all these body plan originations were not driven by there being hordes of new species appearing and creating this vast morphological distance. Not at all. They were being driven by something else. Now, the earliest forms to become really abundant include a sponge-like group called the archaeocyathids and an arthropod group called the trilobites. Everyone's familiar with trilobites, beautiful fossils. And these guys just turned over like crazy. They had very short spans of duration, the species did, or the genera, or the families, however, whatever level of taxonomy you investigate, they turned over very fast. So the species didn't last very long, but they speciated very, very rapidly. So there was this vast evolutionary activity within these groups. And that's sort of what you'd expect if you had a relatively empty environment, and then you suddenly created a whole bunch of new organisms and said, okay, go fill it. Who's going to fill it first? It's going to be the guys that can speciate most rapidly, that can get out there and take control of the resources that were available before somebody else does. So the fast guys are going to explode into this empty biological space. And the slow guys are not necessarily going to go extinct, but they're not going to be dominant. However, as we go through geological time, these early rapid turnover clades, like trilobites, like archaeocyathids, begin to take a terrible beating. Every time there's an extinction, these guys, which, although they can make species rapidly, they don't last very long, so they're not very resistant to environmental change. They really take a big hit. Whenever there's even a minor extinction, they take more of a hit than the slow turnover guys who don't make very many species or don't make them very rapidly, but whose species tend to last a long time. And it's really a clear contrast, and that's something we can measure in the fossil record because we can see them come in and we can see them go out and we can tell how long they've been around. So the turnover rates is something we can measure fairly well, ballpark. And the fast guys begin to lose out through geological time. First, the trilobites and the archaeocyathids go or become very minor elements of the fauna. The next groups that dominate the oceans, anyway, are brachiopods and crinoids. And these have slower turnover rates than the trilobites and archaeocyathids. And then there's a really big extinction about 225 million years ago, Permian-Triassic extinction. And the groups that do best after that in the oceans are clams and snails, mollusks. And these are very slow turnover guys that just take forever to become extinct and do not speciate very rapidly compared with the members of the previous clades. So when we go out to the oceans today, the dominant skeletonized forms are mollusks. And the reason they are is that it's slow and steady wins in this game. And they've just outlasted everything and increased their diversity gradually. When there's a big extinction, they don't take as much of a hit as anyone else. And although they don't come back as fast, they're not as low either. And they've just dominated the oceans. When you look at life on land, which most of us have a better feel for, why, among animals, it's not quite as clear, but the same principle seems to hold, that the slower evolving groups tend to do better over geological time. Insects, for example, which you might think turn over fast and there's zillions of the damn things, are in fact relatively slow turnover guys. The one group that goes, and you might think, well, you know, what are you saying? You're saying that the organisms that are less prone to extinction are going to win. That doesn't seem like a big deal, does it? But as a matter of fact, if you look at plants, for example, they do just the opposite. The major plant groups, as we go through time, turn over faster and faster, so that flowering plants are turning over much faster and have a very high evolutionary dynamic compared with the very early kinds of plants. And there's been a stepwise increase in the rate of turnover in plants. So it's possible to win by being able to produce a lot of species and hang in there. And it's also possible to win by lasting a long time, even though you don't produce very many species. So there's two strategies, and it turns out that plants, which I've always suspected of being nefarious anyway, have adopted the wrong strategy as far as animals are concerned. But they're doing fine.
What are the fundamental predictions of Darwinian theory as it relates to paleontology? Are these fundamental predictions met by the fossil evidence?
Well, the prediction that was being made from neo-Darwinian theory about what we should see in the fossil record, turns out it isn't really required in the theory, but it was sort of assumed to be so. And that is that evolution has been exceedingly gradual and that change has been very measured. And therefore, whenever we see novelties appear in the fossil record, it, without an obvious event associated with it just then, it implies that there was a long missing history of evolution working up to this event from previous times. And Darwin, in fact, thought that events took longer than they actually did. He estimated the ages of some fossil deposits, and he was always long on them. He always had them too far back, although everyone else at the time had them far too young. He overdid it in the opposite direction.
Is Darwinian gradualism consistent with the fossil record and the origin of the phyla?
Another implication of neo-Darwinian theory, and something that Darwin believed, was that there must have been a long previous history, therefore, to the origin of the major kinds of animals we have, that to get to arthropods or to chordates, mammals such as we are, belong to the chordates, must have taken a long time. A lot of gradual evolution went into building up to them. The fossil record has never been very helpful in substantiating this idea. For example, the phyla, the major groups of animals, appear relatively abruptly within just a few million years. Those that have a chance of appearing, that have skeletons or something so they can get in the fossil record, there they are, by and large, within a few million years, or several million years, between 530 and 540 million years ago, something like that. And there aren't very many species or genera or orders or classes around. The phyla come in, and then they diversify into classes, and then into order. These diversify into orders, and so on. So it's, so to speak, top down. It is as if someone created the phyla, and then these diversified into orders and classes and so forth. So the body plans seem to come first, and then their major subdivisions second, rather than a gradual progression from species to genera to families and stuff, working up to the body plans of phyla. However, since we have incontrovertible evidence of evolution, why, there must have been a period before the appearance of the body plan when, in fact, evolution was working up, if not from species to genera to families, at least from simple forms, single cell forms and stuff, to the more complicated forms that we do see when they appear in the early Cambrian period, about 530 to 540 million years ago.
Because of the lack of fossil evidence for gradual evolution, Darwin devoted an entire chapter in his Origin of Species to the imperfection of the geological record. How incomplete is the record?
Well, completeness is a technical stratigraphic term, and to be certain of how to answer that question, you have to ask yourself, how complete for what? For a million-year interval? For a thousand-year interval? The record is a lot more complete for a million-year intervals. For example, there's more likely to be some sediment in each million years compared to some sediment in each thousand years. So if you don't mind looking at the record with rather coarse vision, it's quite complete. If you look at it with a very fine tooth comb and you want some record to be, represent every year that there have ever been or something, you're out of luck. So how complete things are depends on the kind of question you're trying to ask. When it comes to the origin of phyla and the late Precambrian record just before the phyla appear, the record is plenty complete enough to show us what was going on. There are lots of sediments from over 50 localities around the world which have good sections which have yielded fossils. When you get that many samples of an interval of just, you know, a few tens of millions of years or something, it means that the record is reasonably complete. So we're quite confident that the pattern we're seeing is not an artificial one, not caused by lack of the fossil record. The rocks are there, plenty of rocks, perfectly good rocks, laid down in the appropriate environment. So the fossils we see probably record the story that happened.
Are ancestral fossil series leading to any of the major phyla known in the fossil record?
There are no known series of fossils that lead to a phyla or even to classes. They just appear with this top-down pattern. When we get back before the phyla appear, we find the trace fossils, marks left in the sediment by the activities of organisms, but we don't find body fossils. They didn't have skeletons, and although we have some impressions of some groups, they're not impressions of the groups that were ancestral to the living higher invertebrates, the bilateria as they're called, things above the level of jellyfish and sea anemones and things like that.
Eldridge and Gould have claimed that the two key features of the fossil record are sudden appearance and stasis. Does the hypothesis of punctuated equilibrium adequately explain the origin of the higher taxa?
Punctuated equilibrium is a hypothesis to explain the pattern of appearance and disappearance of species lineages. So when we're dealing with punctuated equilibrium, or punk ek as it's known, why, we're dealing with a much lower sort of evolutionary event than the origin of whole new body plans. It's the punk ek is slightly a misnomer because there was not really a punctuation in the sense of an immediate jump from one species to another, nor was there necessarily an equilibrium. But what we do have is a relative morphological stasis in some lineages, And then the sudden appearance of what is obviously a descendant species, which then becomes a sister to the other group, which appears abruptly. But the answer to this goes back a little bit to the completeness of the fossil record, because while we're able to pick these sisters up, we're usually not able to resolve the relatively narrow period of time in which they originate. But it wasn't instantaneous. It might have been 10, 20,000 years, something like that. That's plenty of time under existing microevolutionary theory to develop a new species. So it's just that once you've got the species, they're able to adapt very well and hang on for maybe an average of 4 or 5 million years. But it only takes them 10 or 20 million years to appear, something, 10 or 20,000 years to appear, something like that. So they appear very abruptly, and then they last a long time. And that pattern is called a punctuational pattern.
Can punctuated equilibrium be extrapolated to account for the origin of the phyla?
Well, punctuated equilibrium was hypothesized to occur within species lineages, and although the higher taxa appear abruptly, it's not quite the same problem as species appearing abruptly, because one would expect that a phylum would take, the body plan of a phylum would take a very long time to assemble through geological time, whereas one can imagine a species splitting off from a parent within a few thousand years or a little more, so that we couldn't resolve that event in the fossil record. But to get a phylum coming in is punctuation on a different scale. It's really not part of the hypothesis of punctuated equilibrium. Among the ideas for the origin of phyla, though, has been that it was driven by speciation events, and that these little jumps that give you new species, sometimes they're fairly large morphological jumps, if your eyes are scaled to the difference between species, could be added up, and again, this is a bottom-up pattern, to form phyla. But if you look at the fossil record, the time is just not available for a start, because even that takes a while, because you have to spend some time in stasis between these jumps when nothing much is going on, and you start adding up the time you need to do that from evolutionary theory, and it gets to be too long. Additionally, there are not very many species in the early fossil record. And if there is a body of theory that's called species selection, which suggests that in some cases evolution produces a lot of species, and then those that happen to be better adapted are the ones that are kind of selected to go on, and the others become extinct. And in this way, you can change the trend of morphology by selecting among species rather than by selecting within species and having trends go that way. And that's not unlikely to have occurred, but it can't account for the origin of phyla, partly because there just weren't that many species. To get an adequate pool of species from which to select just the ones you need requires an awful lot, and they just aren't there. The number of species present in the late Precambrian and early Cambrian is relatively low. We're talking thousands to tens of thousands, maybe, but not the millions that you'd need to generate phyla if that were the only way that you could get them in.
Why is the cell type hypothesis a better explanation for the origin of the phyla than competing ideas?
One thing worrying about cell type number does for you is to sort of organize your thinking about what was going on just before the Cambrian explosion. When I first submitted a paper discussing this hypothesis, and that's all it really is, it's certainly not a fact yet, one of the reviewers remarked that he was surprised that someone would suggest this, because as everyone knows, the Cambrian-Precambrian boundary was a time of explosive increase in complexity. And I think that was sort of in a lot of people's heads, that there hadn't been much before the Cambrian, and then suddenly there was this big burst of complexity generating living phyla and some extinct ones probably as well. But if you think about what had to precede that explosion and worry about the trace fossils and the gradual increase in cell type numbers from some unicellular progenitor, which just had one or possibly two if it was colonial, to the kinds of organisms we see at Cambrian, which had 30, 40, 50 cell types, something like that, we're not sure. Let's say 30. Why, well, let's say 40. Why, there had to be some organisms in there with 10, and some with 15, and some with 25, and so on. So you begin to see the possibility that there was a gradual workup to the Cambrian explosion insofar as the complexity of body plans is concerned. And that, therefore, means that when the Cambrian explosion occurred, it wasn't necessary to make a huge jump in complexity. All you had to do was take the building blocks of organisms that you had already evolved and reshuffle them and get this kind of lateral explosion in new body plans, but not greatly in complexity. Now, again, this is just a hypothesis, but it gives a more plausible explanation, I think, of what must have preceded the explosion than the idea that was sort of in the air before and hadn't been thought through. And in that respect, it's valuable.
What major problems remain to be solved with regard to the origin of the phyla?
Well, I can't pretend to outline all the major problems that lie ahead of us, but I think a really important trend in paleontology is going to be, of all things, an alliance with molecular biology. The tools of molecular biology are so powerful that we're able to, for example, trace the branching order of major groups of animals. More than that, by looking inside the genome, molecular paleontologists have identified the kinds of genes that regulate the expression of other genes. These regulatory genes control the pattern of expression, and certainly the differences between the major groups of organisms are not so much in the kind of genes they have. Everyone's genes go back to some primitive organism, you know, and it's been duplicated or changed slightly. So all these genes are very ancient. The difference is in the pattern of expression, the way the genome is wired, so that the number of cell types that are produced, the tissues that they produce, the organs that are made up of those tissues and the organ systems from those that go to make the whole organism, the whole architecture of the thing, is regulated by a certain class of genes. Homeobox genes are an important member of this class. And so we're soon going to understand what kind of changes inside the genome in this regulatory system are required in order to give us the morphological changes that we see. Then we can go back to the fossil record and say, at this point, the regulatory genome was evolving. During this late Precambrian time, when we start with the single-celled organisms and work up to the complexity of 40 or say, a system of cell differentiation was being assembled, and a system of pattern formation genes which would control the axes of the body plan, and then a lot of selector genes which specify just exactly what parts of the organism turn into, whether a segment has a leg on it or a wing or whatnot. And all this stuff was being worked out in the late Precambrian and early Cambrian, and we're going to be able to recreate, I believe, that sequence of events by combining the evidence from the fossil record with the results of these powerful investigations in molecular biology. And I see that, at least in my field, as the most important thing looming in the immediate future.
What would you most like to be remembered for?
I think I'd like to be remembered for having produced a number of graduate students who go ahead and solve the problems we've been talking about finally and make the next major steps in our field.
What was the general view of natural history prior to 1859?
Most people at that time were creationists. Even the natural scientists were by and large creationists, although there were a few of them that had their doubts and thought there might be some kind of evolutionary process at work, chiefly because the species could be grouped into allied forms that had very similar plans, like all insects look like insects and mammals look like mammals. And so that there was some question as to why the structure of living beings was distributed in the pattern it was. But most people thought that it was just created that way.
What was so revolutionary about Darwin's Origin of Species?
Well, Darwin gave us a mechanism to account for the kinds of changes you needed in order to actually evolve this pattern of morphological disparity that we see between groups like arthropods and annelids and men and so forth. All these great distinctions between species could be accommodated by Darwin's theory in that these groups had common ancestors that lay in the very remote past.
What pervasive pattern did Darwin expect to find in the fossil record?
Well, if Darwin would have been describing the evolution of the tree of life, he would have started with a common ancestor of all animals, which then would branch and would speciate, and branches would arise from these species and gradually diverge as the species became adapted to different conditions of existence in different parts of the environmental mosaic. And pretty soon, you'd have groups of species that were descended from common ancestors in one place and groups of species descended from common ancestors in another place that could be called genera. And as time went on and species continued to multiply, these genera could be grouped into families and the families into orders. And so the natural hierarchy would be accounted for by the continued branching of the tree.
Darwinian theory predicts a bottom-to-top pattern of geological succession. As species diversify, new genera, families, orders, classes, and ultimately new phyla should be generated. Does the fossil record confirm or contradict this bottom-to-top pattern?
Darwin had a lot of trouble with the fossil record because if you look at the record of phyla in the rocks as fossils, why, when they first appear, we already see them all. That is, the phyla are fully formed. It's as if the phyla were created first, and then they were modified into classes, and we see that the number of classes peak later than the number of phyla, and then the number of orders peaks later than that. So it's just kind of a top-down succession. You start with these basic body plans of phyla, and you diversify them into classes, the major subdivisions of phyla, and these into orders, and so on. So the fossil record is kind of backwards from what you'd expect from, in that sense, from what you'd expect from Darwin's ideas. Although once we get into the fossil record, where we've got a complete fossil record, we can see the gradual changes within lineages, just as Darwin predicted.
How did Darwin reconcile his theory with the fossil record?
Well, he was very sure his theory was correct, so he had to say that the geological record was very imperfect, and that if we had a perfect geologic record, we would see these gradual changes, and we would see the buildup, the right side up, so to speak, buildup rather than the upside down buildup to the body plans that constitute living phyla. And in fact, this is a first edition of The Origin of Species, written in 1859, published in 1859, and I'd just like to read a passage from it that makes this point. He's talking about intermediate links between living species, or it could be phyla, orders, some taxonomic groups. He says, "Why then is not every geological formation and every stratum full of such intermediate links? Geology assuredly does not reveal any such finely graduated organic chain. And this, perhaps, is the most obvious and gravest objection which can be urged against my theory." He realized that he was in trouble here. "The explanation lies, as I believe, in the extreme imperfection of the geologic record." So he assumed that rocks older than those where we first see phyla appearing had been destroyed or were submerged under the ocean or were otherwise removed from observation, so that the record was imperfect down there. And if we had the record, we could see this right side up evolution.
Have research efforts since 1859 helped to reconcile the conflicts between Darwinian theory and paleontology.
Paleontologists have uncovered a long history of animals that Darwin didn't know about, that preceded the appearance of the skeletonized forms that Darwin knew about in the fossil record. Those date from about 525 million years ago, we know now. And we have fossils back to about 560 million years ago, so we've got another 35 to 40 million years of good fossil record of animals. In fact, we have a record of life that extends back 3.5 billion years, but those early creatures were not animals. They were microbes and other kinds of unicellular organisms. The multicellular organisms that comprise animals seem to have started earlier than 600 million years ago, and our first good record of them picks up at about 580 million years.
Have these new discoveries solved the problem of the origin of phyla?
Oddly enough, these finds of fossils older than the appearance of the living phyla haven't done much to solve our problems with the origins of phyla. There are two chief kinds of fossils found in earlier rocks than during the Cambrian explosion. One kind are trace fossils made by worms or some vermiform animal crawling along, maybe a slug-like animal. It's left a trail in the mud or possibly burrowing very shallowly. Most of these are horizontal, as if some ancient animal were crawling along over the old seafloor, and was complex enough to actually move the sediment and make a trail. It takes a reasonable amount of complexity to do that. The other kind of body fossils we have are of kind of jellyfish-looking or frond-like-looking organisms, which differ from living organisms and are clearly not the direct ancestors of the phyla that we see when the Cambrian comes. Because when we begin to see those phyla, there's no doubt about them. They look like they're living descendants as far as their body plan goes. They're more primitive, they're different, but they have the complexity of organization that their living counterparts have.
What did the early members of the phyla look like?
The early members of the living phyla looked very much like modern members, although they have a kind of peculiar cast to them that we interpret as being primitive. Snails, the mollusks have representatives that look like little coil shells, much like snails look. Some of them may be snails. Some of them may belong to a living class that's less well known than snails, called monoplacophorans, that live in deeper waters in the ocean today. The early arthropods look very much like modern arthropods. They're segmented. Most of the segments have joint appendages on them, just like the walking legs of modern arthropods. The legs look a little different. They look primitive. But there they are. The basic body plan is in place. Echinoderms, which include starfish and sea stars and things like that, look very much like the living ones, except they do have this primitive look. Many of them do not have the beautiful five-fold symmetry that modern echinoderms have. They're rather irregular. Aside from that, they have the same kind of skeletons made up of kind of porous plates that are hooked together as living echinoderms do. They're unmistakable.
Can the origin of the major phyla in the Cambrian explosion be explained on the basis of punctuated equilibrium?
Niles Eldridge and Steve Gould generated a hypothesis to account for the sudden appearance of species lineages in the fossil record. We tend not to see intermediates between species. The average marine species might last 4 or 5 million years, and it becomes extinct, and there'll be another species around which was derived from it. We won't see the intermediates during the derivation because that happens relatively rapidly, maybe in thousands of years. But then the species might last millions of years, so we do see the species. We have often a very good record of the species. It has a lot of chances to be in the fossil record. However, the intermediates have a very small chance to be in the fossil record. So we get this punctuated pattern of a species morphology lasting a few million years and a sudden jump to another species morphology, and maybe an overlap of these two morphologies. So species appear abruptly in the record, and they disappear abruptly. With phyla, they appear abruptly in the record also, but to get a phylum requires that
novel characteristics be built up over a long period of geological time. And when you're going from one species to another, all you're doing is generating a kind of a variation on the same theme. To go from one species of one phylum to a species of another phylum requires a whole lot of intermediate species, or at least a whole lot of intermediate evolution, with the introduction of a whole suite of novelties which create the body plan of the new phylum from its ancestral body plan. And this doesn't happen overnight. So even though the phyla appear suddenly, you could call that an abrupt, it's certainly an abrupt appearance, it does not, it can't be explained by this process of punctuated equilibrium.
From what we see in the fossil record, natural history looks more like a forest than a tree of life. How can the theory of universal common ancestry be reconciled with the fossil evidence?
The naturalists, before Darwin's time even, had the fossils grouped into taxa, into systematic categories like classes and orders and genera and so forth, by how closely they resemble each other. So it's natural enough when you're going to arrange the phyla and figure out which phylum evolved in concert with which are the sister phyla to each other, to put those phyla that resemble each other most closely together. However, the phyla are so disparate, they have such a distinctive body plans, many of them, that morphologists, in trying to relate them to each other, just completely disagreed. There are different schools of morphology who will say this phylum preceded this phylum, and another school, equally impressive, populated by great zoologists, who will say it's the other way around. And just about any possible tree that you can draw linking phyla together has been held to be true by one zoologist or another at some time based on the comparative morphology of the phyla and the developmental patterns that we can see as the young of the phyla develop into the adult. So we've really had a very hard time arranging the tree of life to everyone's satisfaction. It hasn't been done until just recently. We've had a breakthrough. Recently, within the last 20 years, the science of molecular biology has burgeoned, and among the tools we now have available are molecular comparisons of the genes of species that are in different phyla, and this has begun to solve our problems.
Do the disparate body plans represented by the phyla represent disparate genomes?
Although the body plans of phyla are so very different, phyla are amazingly similar biochemically. They must have, in the high 90% of gene functions that are similar among the different phyla. So the main differences between them isn't that they have genes that do very different things, it's that the genes are expressed in different ways in the different body plans. If you start with an egg and you want to end up with a mollusk, why, you take a set of genes and you express them in certain orders to create certain cell types and to put the cell types in certain places to create the architecture of a mollusk. If you start with an egg and you want to end up with an arthropod, you need a different developmental pattern to end up with an arthropod. But approximately the same kinds of genes are involved in each of these sequences. What's controlling these genes is a hierarchical cascading system of regulatory factors, which are genes themselves, which turn on and off the genes that actually make up the physical parts of the body or whose products do. So if you have this sort of kit of tools, you have a genome capable of producing a complex metazoan body, and then you wire it for arthropods, you get an arthropod, and then you can rewire almost the same genes, and you can get a mollusk, or you can get a mammal. This gives us a hint of how it might have been possible to generate a lot of distinctive body plans in very short order, because evolution didn't have to reinvent, if you'll pardon the expression, reinvent every last gene in every different body plan. It already had
a set of genes, let's say in the common ancestor of two body plans, all these genes were present, or almost all of them. Basic functions were there. What had to be done was the developmental pathways had to be changed from one body plan to another. That's much easier than starting from scratch and reinventing the whole thing. And because of this reshuffling of gene expression, pattern of gene expression changing, it seems possible that would account for the relatively rapid evolution of body plans. Given that there weren't any body plans around to speak of, we had an open environment, all this evolutionary opportunity out there, and a genome that was capable of exploiting it by evolving different body plans quite rapidly.
Could you describe your cell type hypothesis and how it relates to the origin of phyla?
Animals are multicellular organisms. That is, you and I, human beings, have maybe 215 different kinds of cells in our body, billions of cells, but if you sort them out into different types, there would be 215 plus nerve cells, which might be another couple hundred actually, but lumping nerve cells, which are very difficult to work with. Why, there's over 200 cell types. Yet the first animal had like two cell types, or maybe three. It evolved from a single-celled organism that only had one cell type. So at some point in the past, the single-celled organism evolved into a two-celled organism, and then into an organism with three cell types, and so on, to eventually arrive at mammals, which have over 200 cell types. On the way up in this increasing complexity of cell type number, we find intermediate levels of organisms, such as clams and snails, which may have 40, 45 cell types, 50 something in that range. Arthropods, which simple arthropods also have about 40, 45 cell types. Echinoderms, a few more, maybe 50, 55, something like that. But there seems to be a level of cell type number that most higher organisms have. It's about 40, 45. And if we look at the organisms that appear during the Cambrian explosion about 530 million years ago, something like that, they require about 40 or 45 cell types. So one can assume as one goes back from there that 20 million years before then, the most complex organisms around probably only had 30 cell types or 25, and we keep going back, and eventually we'll come to an organism that just had one cell type, and that's the origin of the animals. Now, if you look at the most complex organisms around at any given time, like 215 now for us, and start tracing it back, why, it makes a nice curve of increasing complexity, of decreasing complexity as you go back until you hit zero. So before the Cambrian explosion, at about 40 cell types, there had to be a workup in complexity from a single cell type to that 40 cell type level. And that is the bottom-up part of evolution. And if you trace the rate of cell type increase from the Cambrian to today, and then extrapolate that back, you come out a little before 600 million years ago,